Olá pessoal, boa tarde. Estamos aqui novamente, agora com o episódio número 15 da websérie O Mundo Empreendedor Expedição Israel. Estamos aqui toda quinta, 1h30, sempre com um convidado de peso, falando sobre os assuntos mais relevantes no ambiente de inovação e empreendedorismo aqui em Israel, um dos maiores polos tecnológicos do mundo. Eu sou Daniel Scaba, CEO da Ibitech, que tem aproximado esse rico ecossistema de inovação do público brasileiro. Já estou por aqui há quase 30 anos, vivenciando inovação e tecnologia em todas as suas formas, na faculdade, no exército, em multinacionais e também como empreendedor. Agora, aqui com vocês, mergulhando nesse mundo de inovação e empreendedorismo. E antes de chamar nosso convidado especial de hoje, gostaria de chamar, como sempre, a nossa Bárbara para passar uns recados. Oi, Bárbara, boa tarde.
Boa tarde, Daniel. Boa tarde, pessoal. Vim aqui hoje, no frio que está aqui em Juiz de Fora, Minas Gerais, trazer para vocês alguns materiais complementares. Então, bom, se vocês acessarem aqui o nosso manual de bordo, além de ter acesso a todos os nossos materiais que a gente já fez até hoje, então, literalmente uma imersão dentro de Israel, vocês também vão ter acesso a vários materiais complementares. E o de hoje são os seguintes. Os artigos, como o ecossistema de inovação arrecadou 2,5 bilhões de dólares em 2021 e o mundo empreendedor, como empreender no exterior. Então, se vocês querem saber um pouquinho mais aí sobre como esse mundo funciona e como esse ecossistema tem movimentado tanto dinheiro e tantas pessoas ao longo aí de 2021, acesse com a gente e fique sabendo. Além disso, convidar vocês também a participarem aqui, se inscreverem no nosso canal, já deixar o like no vídeo, porque com certeza esse conteúdo vai ser sucesso, e também participarem com a gente no Insight Premiado. Então, basta vocês enviarem um printzinho ali no seu Instagram Stories, marcando o arroba Grupo Voito e colocando qual é o insight que você gostaria de compartilhar com as pessoas, que pronto, você já vai estar participando e já pode concorrer a um kit Voito ou a um livro Excel da nossa editora. Então, assim, bora lá. Hoje a gente vai ter muito mais insights aí para contribuir com vocês, né, Daniel?
Vamos sim, hoje vai ser ótimo com o Yotam. Obrigadíssimo, Bárbara. And now I would like to invite Yotam Zucker for a chat about the challenges of building a global innovation ecosystem. Olá, Yotam, tudo bem?
Olá, olá, tudo, como vai, todos? Thank you, Daniel, for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be with you here and to speak about Israel, Brazil, and about innovation. It's something that I love the most, two of my favorite countries in the world.
That's great to have you here. And guys, Yotam has a BA in Industrial Engineering by Ben Gurion University in Be'er Sheva, here in Israel, and an MBA in Innovation and Entrepreneurship. Who invented this word, entrepreneurship? By IDC Herzliya, also in Israel. Yotam founded Tech7, an innovation ecosystem in Be'er Sheva, with the purpose of promoting regional, social, and economic growth via building local attractivity for startups and other high-tech companies. Today, Yotam is the head of business development of CQ Global, helping companies building excellent teams around the globe. Yotam, you decided to create Tech7 about 5 or 6 years ago. What was the need to create an innovation ecosystem?
So thank you, Daniel, for the question, and I'm very happy to speak about that. So as you said, 6 years ago, we started the Tech Sheva, the innovation ecosystem creator in Be'er Sheva. We didn't have much of tech companies in our region. The university wasn't involved enough in entrepreneurship. And I remember myself with a couple of my friends back in the day, really looking to get inspired from entrepreneurs, from CEO, and from people who have done it, since we really, really want to be part of something big. And you know, we felt like underdog because in Israel there's so much stuff going on, and Israel considered as a startup nation, and you are hearing all the time in the news lots of story of great startup who raised lots of money. And then yeah, when you drive 1 hour to 1 hour south to Be'er Sheva, just to give the audience like the geography of Be'er Sheva. So Be'er Sheva is located 1.5 hours south from Tel Aviv, which considered in terms of Israel a very far away city. And we felt like out of the zone. We really want to build something and to position ourselves, our community, our city, our region as a leading community in the innovation ecosystem. And we started to build this partnership. We started to speak with the companies that arrived to Be'er Sheva. We started to gather all the relevant ecosystem players in the region in order to establish it correctly. And we started to do so much stuff to attract more talents and to attract the ecosystem creator to build the community. And at the end of the day, we built something that we felt that is missing, and we built something that we really wanted for ourselves. So we didn't build something for somebody else. We built something that we want our city to have.
And you mentioned the university, and you mentioned that in Tel Aviv and Jerusalem, there were already some rich ecosystems. So what are the key elements in order to be able to create innovation ecosystem? The university, support of government, other things?
So I think the world ecosystem is like an all system that should work together in order to flourish the innovation and the startups at the end of the day. And you must have, I think there are must things that you have to have in your own ecosystem, and they are all the rest are nice to have, but also important. So the must have, you have to have an university, you have to have a strong education system in your city. And why is that? Because this is like an anchor of talent. In our university, we have every year 20,000 students, most of them coming from the engineering, and this is something that is a recruiting. The second thing that is very important is to have a strong sponsorship and a strong government, as well as the municipality, because at the end of the day, even if you want the private sector to create something, you need to have the support of the government. You need to have something that happening from your municipality. So we were fortunate enough to have the support of the government and the municipality. And you have to have the private sector, a strong private sector. It's better to have bigger companies that believe in the city and see the potential of the city. So we had this triangle of private sector, governmental sector, and the higher education system in Be'er Sheva. And you have to work to understand how should the three of them work together and build underneath this structure the community, the startups, the innovation program, the education program for entrepreneurship, and create and community and create a network out of them in order to really flourish your own local ecosystem.
And when you decided to create this ecosystem, you decided a specific vertical as health, cyber, or it was more a general ecosystem?
So Be'er Sheva is considered to be a cyber leading city. It was a decision made by the government of Israel, I think like 20 years ago. And looking backward, I think it was a really great idea to position your region or to position your community as a vertical community. And why is that? Because at the end of the day, I won't say 50% of our activity wasn't related to cyber. But it's very important to say that this city or this region is good at X, is good at a specific vertical. And when you're doing so, you're attracting a great companies or a great opportunity in this specific sector. And people say, ah, okay, you are from Beersheba. Beersheba is the cyber city. Ah, you are from this city. Your city is this city. And it creates awareness that reflect to other type of verticals. So I think that building an ecosystem around a specific sector, there and therefore you can build like a program, specific program inside the university. For example, we have a strong cyber program in Beersheba. Beersheba has attracted lots of cyber companies to the tech park. The government of Israel has incentivized, gave incentive to multinational companies to open R&D centers related to cyber. And what happened is afterwards, after the cyber has come to Beersheba, few other companies said, okay, something happening in Beersheba. I want to be part of this. I want to understand how can I attract talent over there, and I want to open another R&D center. So today, for example, we have companies NVIDIA and we have Wix, which are definitely not cyber companies, since they have understood that the potential of being part of a strong ecosystem, being part of a strong community, and gain the exposure to tech talent, which it's really hard for them to get in different region.
That's very good. And Yotam, the story of Tech Sheva, Tech Seven. So for you Brazilians, Sheva is seven in Hebrew. And so the story of Tech Seven inspired several Brazilian organizations to replicate its success in Brazil. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience with Brazil?
So I have to admit that this was the best time of my life doing business in Brazil and having the opportunity to meet Brazilian and to help some of them take the knowledge of Beersheba and the knowledge of Tech Sheva and make the same thing in Brazil. And this story is starting, I think, like 4 years ago when we had a group of Brazilian coming to visit us in our offices in Beersheba. And I was telling the story, not over Zoom, but really face to face. I was telling them, look, we had like a few years ago, we had in a desert. You can see it in the picture. And now you are locating in a space. We have 4 buildings already, 5,000 employees. We have the government of Israel involved. We have municipality involved. We have the university involved. We have a strong startups community. We already have a few investors that are going on in the city. And this is something that you can replicate. It's not that easy, but with the right motivation and aspiration, you can do the same thing in Brazil. And what I found out that the Brazilian are really like local patriots. They really want to make their own region, their own ecosystem, and their own cities be better. They have like an aspiration, and they are looking to make Brazil better and to make their own local region flourish. So I was few times in Brasilia, in Mato Grosso, in Florianópolis, in Chapecó, in Rio de Janeiro. So I was really visiting few cool places in Brazil, and I met with like local community leaders. I met with universities. I met with like municipality of Rio de Janeiro, for example. And I saw that there are lots of potential in Brazil. There is a lot of tech talent. And sometimes you feel that things are missing. Like Brazilians, I really want to conquer the world. They really want to do big stuff. They have like lots of dreams. And lots of motivation, and we started to speak how we can develop and how we can develop this bridge. It's something that you guys are doing, IBI Tech, this bridge between Israel and Brazil, how we can take into consideration some of the things that we have done in Israel, because in the end of the day, we were also underdog in Beersheba. We were like a periphery city. We weren't like We weren't like New York City or Tel Aviv or Sao Paulo. Okay, these cities are like the everything is good there, like things are going on, the economy is fine. It's just like you don't need to do nothing. What we spoke about, places that were out of the main center region, and still they have lots of potential, they have lots of resources, they have lots of strong talent, university, academia, government incentive. And at the end of the day, sometimes all you need to do is just come with the right macro plan, connect all the dots and execute together like a proper plan to make the city flourish and to give the young entrepreneurs the option and the opportunity. So as I told you, Daniel, I was visiting lots of places in Brazil. Unfortunately, the COVID hit us, so we kind of stopped traveling. I hope to really come back again to Brazil. And I really believe in the Brazilian ecosystem. I know that there are great people over there and great talent, and people are really desire to build big companies.
You mentioned about the several elements for the ecosystem, and we understand that one of the most important things on the ecosystem is the collaboration. So what are the important things to promote the knowledge transfer between the different institutions and organizations?
I think the most important thing, we call it, if you skip on the ecosystem, you receive an ecosystem. So what does it mean? It nice. Means that in every place there is ego. No matter where you go, no matter what you do, there is the ego who is playing. And then when you're speaking about like develop an ecosystem, so every time when I meet like new places or I'm visiting a new ecosystem, I see that there is like sometimes there's the municipality who want to take over the ecosystem, sometimes it's the academia, sometimes there is like a big investor who said I want to be on this. And I think at the end of the day, there is no opportunity to do it alone, no matter how big and strong you are. Since develop the region, it's something that you need to have. You need to have the, like the local partners to do it. You need to have a strong plan, and you have to have all the players to play in the same playground. And then I've never seen in my life like municipality who have changed the city alone, or like academia who have changed the city alone. And it's always about the partnership between the people. It's always about no one is trying to take control or to take ownership on the ecosystem. And I promise you that if you feel that there is someone over there in that try to like take control over something, and the end of the day they want to have the same credibility as someone in a strong ecosystem where everybody is collaborating, and there is someone inside this collaboration, the spotlight will be on him, and because 1 + 1 is usually worth 3. And so we really saw it in our own ecosystem, how building collaboration and you know, working together, municipality with university, and then a private sector or like a private incentive in the ecosystem was created from scratch. People gave it the support and promote it, and no one said, but the municipality is doing whatever they want. People really like wanted this to be in the front. And I think at the end of the day, Tech Sheva would never have come to the place that it's today without the support of all the other actors in the ecosystem.
That's great. So Yotam, please, if you let me use the sentence, you have to skip the ecosystem to create an ecosystem, I'll be using that everywhere. I like that.
Yes.
Yotam, today you hold a position as head of business development of CQ Global, helping companies building teams around the world. So the new normal after COVID or during COVID, do you see a new balance between building a local team and a team spread around the world, or in case Brazil, around Brazil?
So actually, something really interesting happened in the last year. That's a different topic, and I think it's super interesting for a Brazilian to hear about it. The boundaries have changed. So I will tell you, like Israel, most of the Israeli companies are building the R&D center, the engineering center in Israel, and then when they want to have like a presence, let's say in the United States, so they are hiring like a local offices. And what's happened in the COVID is that we have understood that the talent is everywhere. You can work remotely, you can sell remotely, you can do the marketing remotely, and you can do everything from wherever you are. And why is that interesting for Brazil? Because Brazil has lots of talented people, and I think in this new era, people will hire you no matter where you are, and no matter where are you located, and no matter who you are. They will hire you only because of the person you are and the skills you have gained along the way. And this is opens opportunity for countries and for people that weren't part of the game till very recently. I think it's the change that is starting now. And you can see in the US, for example, lots of companies are building their team from scratch remotely. Like, people don't care where you are located, you just sometimes need to be in the time zone, which Brazil are really in the time zone of the States. You just need to have the right skills. So gain skills by yourself, build stuff by yourself, try to be involved in the industry as much as you can, learn from the internet as much as you can. And then you can work with the best team in the world and on the best challenges in the world, no matter where you are. I think this is a great opportunity now for the world to be more equal and to spread the power and the resources out of the center, the center that we used to know, the center, like the Silicon Valley where all the companies are going. It might change very soon. It might have the opportunity that companies will be remote, work remotely, and people will be in Sao Paulo, Brasilia, Mexico City, New York, Chicago, and Tel Aviv. And it's crazy. This is a great opportunity for people to join the train of the technology, to join the train of innovation. And I'm very happy to see this. And I really see the change is happening just now. We are just in the beginning of a revolution.
It's very interesting because you just told us two. I don't say that completely different directions. For in the beginning of this conversation, you mentioned the need to create a local innovation ecosystem. And the end of your conversation mentioned the new normal where people can be all over the world. How we can actually balance between these two things?
But it's. I think it's really relevant as someone who is like trying to build local communities. Okay, so at the end of the day, people need community, right? I know many people who don't want to live in Tel Aviv, but they have to live in Tel Aviv since all the ecosystem and the work here. I know the same thing about Sao Paulo and the same thing about New York. Why should someone live in New York if he doesn't want to live there? He doesn't want to pay the same rent. He wants to have a cool house with dogs and three children running in the yard, and you want to live in the periphery. People, lots of people want this type of life. But in the end of the day, you want to be part of a community, right? So imagine to yourself that now with the new normal, you can live in Minas Gerais, you can live in Brasilia or Chapecó even, you know, Mato Grosso, okay? You have a local community, you have a local strong community, you can work, you have like a people and talent people around you to help you to innovate, to help you think, because you need this. But you can work for Google San Francisco. You can work for a cool startup from Israel. You can work for a startup from Hong Kong. It doesn't really matter, but you can live wherever you want, wherever your family is, and to work in the top companies in the world. This is amazing. This is a great change for you. Don't need to live in New York City. I wish it will be that way, but you don't need to live in New York City anymore to work for the top, the best firm in the world.
That's very interesting. Yotam, I would like to thank you so much for being here with us. Muitíssimo obrigado por ter trazido a sua experiência para o nosso público, Yotam.
Muito obrigado. I wish you all Brazilian good luck building your own venture and continue to spread innovation in the world. Thank you, Daniel, for inviting me.
Thank you. E agora, convidar novamente a nossa Bárbara. Bárbara, o que você achou dessa conversa inspiradora com o Yotam?
Foi exatamente isso que você falou, Daniel. Inspiradora mesmo, né? E a gente vê também que realmente essa questão de a gente fazer parte de uma comunidade, ela funciona não só no nosso âmbito pessoal, mas também no âmbito da inovação, de como a gente pode desenvolver coisas, né? E aí ele falou bastante da importância desses três principais players, né? Que é o governo, o sistema educacional e também ali o setor privado, né? Então, a gente fazer com que esses três grandes players atuem entre si, né, um comunicando com o outro, um auxiliando o outro nesse grande ecossistema, realmente a gente só tem a ganhar mesmo, porque são basicamente os três principais players dentro da nossa sociedade se comunicando entre si para trocar benefícios, né? Então, quando a gente ouve falar nisso, realmente faz muito sentido, porque é basicamente o que a gente precisa, né? O que a gente fala tanto ao longo dos dias que a gente precisa. Às vezes, estudantes querem ter mais vida prática e aí cobram essa parte de mercado, ou então, às vezes, também cobram um pouco de posicionamento do governo. Então, esses três atuando junto realmente é o melhor dos mundos, né? A gente conseguir esse alinhamento. E aí, uma das partes mais interessantes, né? Aquela parte que ele falou do ecossystem, para a gente realmente sair do ecossystem e construir o ecossystem, né? Então, a gente realmente, essa brincadeira de palavras acaba fazendo com que a gente perceba mesmo que muitas vezes a gente vai construindo uma coisa pensando só no próprio bem ou no próprio resultado que a empresa vai desenvolver, e a gente acaba não pensando em como isso pode ajudar a comunidade, ajudar o mundo, enfim, e fazer essa contribuição. Então, muito bacana. E, por fim, né, esse último contraponto também que você trouxe em relação a... Em um momento, a gente estava falando em relação a local, né? Como a gente pode construir esse ecossistema local. Mas também a importância que é a gente construir esse ecossistema global. E, ao mesmo tempo, a gente vê como eles também precisam ter essa relação entre si, né? Porque o ecossistema global nada mais é do que a construção de vários ecossistemas locais ao longo do mundo, né? E quando a gente faz também com que vários ecossistemas locais tenham esse desenvolvimento, tenham essas referências, seja cada um também pela sua área de conhecimento específica, a gente começa a construir esse ecossistema global e isso passa a fazer sentido. Então, achei muito interessante também essas três visões, principalmente.
Não tenho mais nada a acrescentar. Você pegou os pontos perfeitos aí dessa conversa, que foi realmente interessante. Bárbara, muitíssimo obrigado novamente ao Yotam, e, como sempre, obrigado a vocês por terem aqui, estar aqui com a gente, curtindo esse papo sobre os ecossistemas de inovação. E, pessoal, na semana que vem teremos mais um convidado de peso, então nos encontramos aqui, quinta-feira, 1h30, nos vemos lá. Um abraço grande.